would you do if a letter arrived at your house from somebody you'd never met and an address that you didn't recognize? And inside that letter were complex mathematical proofs and formulas. That's exactly what happened to Jacques Hadamard when he started receiving mail from an unknown and unpublished mathematician named André Bloch. But unlike you or I, Hadamard was himself a mathematician, and he found these proofs to be both elegant and intriguing. He was so excited, in fact, that he immediately wrote back asking Bloch to join him for dinner. The response he got was even more perplexing. It said, owing to circumstances beyond his control, he could not accept the invitation, but he invited Hadamard to visit him instead. Having nothing more to go on than a return address, he decided to pay Bloch a visit. But when he got to 57 Grand Rue Saint-Maurice, he found that it wasn't a residence. It was a mental hospital for the criminally insane. Against his better judgment, he decided to visit Bloch anyway, and found him to be a charming and talkative person. The two of them discussed mathematics for hours, and it wasn't until Hadamard was on the way out that he asked the staff when they expected Bloch might be released. He was shocked to find out that Bloch would never be released. He had been committed involuntarily after brutally murdering three members of his own family, including his own brother. Hadamard couldn't believe that the man that he'd just been talking to was a cold-blooded killer. The hospital staff seemed to agree. Chief psychologist Henri Baruch said he found it difficult to imagine that such a charming, cultivated, polite man could have committed such an act. So how was it then that this model patient who spent his days playing chess and studying math could commit such a violent act? Experts seem to think that it began in 1917 when Bloch was serving in the French army in World War I. During a particularly heated battle, he fell from an observation tower and landed on his head, damaging his prefrontal cortex. But according to Bloch, this had nothing to do with it. When Dr. Baruch asked him about it, he said, "It's a matter of mathematical logic. There were mentally ill people in my family, on the maternal side to be exact. The destruction of the whole branch had to follow as a matter of course. I started my job at the time of the famous meal, but never got a chance to finish it." When Dr. Baruch thought this sounded cold-hearted, Bloch said, "You're using emotional language. Above all, there is mathematics and its laws. You know very well that my philosophy is based on pragmatism and absolute rationality." The mathematics and its laws that he's talking about here is the study of eugenics. Eugenics was a popular idea in the 20th century. It held that things like mental illness, physical handicaps, and hereditary disease should be bred out of society. This idea was behind some of the worst atrocities of the 20th century, like the Holocaust or the Japanese conquest of Asia. The sad irony is that when the Nazis, who were themselves motivated by eugenics, occupied France, Bloch feared for his life and started writing under a pen name to avoid being discovered. Being both Jewish and mentally ill put him doubly at risk. He started publishing papers under the name René Binot and Marcel Segom. Now, this idea of wiping out a whole family line simply because of mental illness might seem crazy, but it was actually standard policy in the US for a long time. Between 1909 and 1979, 20,000 people were sterilized in California mental hospitals. In fact, in 1927, the US Supreme Court ruled that forced sterilization of handicapped people didn't violate the US Constitution, and this wasn't repealed until 1942. As for André Bloch, his legacy continues in mathematics, with things like Bloch's theorem, the Bloch space, Bloch constant, which is still not defined, and Bloch's conjecture. In fact, just before he died, he was awarded the prestigious Becquerel Prize by the French Academy of Sciences. Besides his mathematical proofs, Bloch might also be the one who proves the idea that there's a thin line between genius and insanity.